Here is the news from the Voice of America.
Suppose tomorrow you meet someone and this person says to you, "I'd like to know more about your country." What would you tell them about this great country of ours? Would you tell them about the history of America? What about our government? Do you know anything about the government? What about our living standards? What about our freedom of religion? The educational opportunities that are in this country? Our foreign policy? What about our foreign policy? What about our domestic problems that we have in this country? Would you tell them anything about that?
If you look at all the radio receivers from the 20s and 30s and 40s, they all have AM 550 to 1620, plus they have one or two shortwave bands because shortwave broadcasting was used worldwide. A lot of German immigrants in the Cincinnati area listen to German broadcast from Germany every day to get the news from home. So not only was radio sort of a local thing, but many stations broadcast with up to 50,000 watts of power and could be heard halfway around the world. Well, after 1934, when the FCC was formed, no further commercial shortwave transmitters were licensed. So by the time World War II was declared with Pearl Harbor Day in 1941, the number of transmitters in this country capable of broadcasting beyond our shores was 12. Within Hitler's boundaries, there were 68 radio transmitters, most of them high-powered, several of them running at 150,000 watts, and a few running at 200,000 watts of power in 1941. The Japanese 38 radio transmitters on their side of the world, and they said, "Listen, we have got to do something. High power, we've got to do something to broadcast toward Europe and toward Japan." Out of that meeting, three contracts were let to build high-power shortwave broadcast stations. Two of the companies who built transmitter plants on the West Coast were sort of well-known at the time and are still around in some form, NBC and CBS. The third company was Crosley Broadcasting in Cincinnati.
At this meeting in Washington, D.C., Ronald J. Rockwell, who was really quite an individual, a very basic individual, was called to Washington and supposedly without even batting an eye, why Mr. Rockwell said, "Yes, we can do that. We can build 6 200-kilowatt transmitters." And you must remember the component parts, there was no such thing at that time, especially tubes that would operate at shortwave frequencies. And Crosley Broadcasting started to build the plant here. And in 18 months, why, they had a signal on the air. And shortly after it was on the air, it was in July 1 of 1944 that the first signal was on the air. But it wasn't dedicated until September of 1944. But shortly thereafter, why, Adolf Hitler called this plant the Cincinnati Liars.
There's a tower above the building, and in the tower, that's where the guards stayed during wartime. They had a searchlight up on the top of the tower that could pinpoint and search any part of the perimeter of the 625 acres. They also had the time clocks. The guards actually went around and walked the whole perimeter and checked in with the time clocks like you used to see in the old 1930 movies or whatever, and came back in. But that went on 24 hours a day here until I think a year after the war was over in 1946. And then they did away with the guards.
The first broadcast from the Voice of America was in German. And the first words that were spoken daily at this time, "We shall speak to you about America and the war. The news may be good or it may be bad, but we shall tell you the truth."
This is the Voice of America, reaching you over stations in the 16 and 19 meter bands. This program may be heard simultaneously from Algiers over the 25 meter band. We now bring you the latest news.
Hier spricht die Stimme aus Amerika.
Voice of America in all of its languages and at its highest point was broadcasting in 51 languages, broadcast about 1,000 hours a week of programming.
Music was a very, very important part of the Voice of America operation. Music USA with Willis Conover, and one of the greatest ambassadors that this country ever had regarding music was Louis Armstrong.
I double dare you to sit over here. I double dare you to lend me your ear. Take off your hi-hat and let's get friendly.
And he was played a lot on the Voice of America. And of course, we also broadcast all the United Nations. When Mr. Khrushchev pounded his shoe on the table up at the United Nations, of course, the Voice of America was carrying that.
In 1991, a group from Kharkov in the Ukraine visited Cincinnati in Union Township. A group of government officials, high government officials from the Ukrainian government, were here. They told me that being in a Voice of America station was so special to them. For years and years, they had secretly listened to the Voice of America and said that if they had ever been caught, if anyone had ever known that they listened to the Voice of America, they would have lost their jobs immediately, been thrown out on the street in disgrace. But yet, here they were, sitting in a Voice of America transmitting plant. It was a very special occasion for them. For 50 years of broadcasting and doing it 7 days a week, nearly 24 hours a day, getting signals into Africa and Latin America. It was really historically significant. It was strategically significant during World War II, and no one has any idea how much it contributed to the downfall of communism.
Being over in the Italian area in World War II and listening to the armed forces and some of the Voice of America program is the truthfulness of us and how it was trying to sell this great country of ours. And you could depend on what the Voice of America was saying by the truth that was being told. That it will never be known what value that this plant had on the downfall of especially the Axis powers in Europe, and of course the downfall of communism.
VOA prided itself in telling the truth no matter how bad it was, even on itself. As far as our government was concerned, Watergate, all the nasty things that happened, the world knew about it because VOA broadcast it. We basically told the world the type of life that we lived, and we thought it was the best in the world, and we still do.
Those of you now tuned to 9.585 megahertz are listening to the end of an era in broadcasting.
That morning of November the 14th, our program was supposed to cease at 9 o'clock, and we got a phone call about 5 minutes till, which increased the suspense, and they actually put the next program on, which ended at 1 p.m. So at 1 p.m. on November the 14th, they thought to switch on the transmitter, and the Bethany building went quiet.
In just a few seconds, Ralph Woods, one of the original electrical engineers from Crosley, will throw a switch, and the tubes of the mighty Crosley transmitter will go dead forever. But in the memories of shortwave enthusiasts, those fine old transmitters will resonate for years to come.
And if you'd been around here all those years, there was always a constant hum in this building because there was a transmitter going on. And in that particular moment, you could hear a pin drop. And we said the light went out at Bethany.
In Bethany, Ohio, on a last year's cornfield, there stands tonight a forest of wires and towering poles. These towers, although far from the scene of military conflict, are powerful and effective weapons of war. They are shortwave radio towers, arranged in rhombic patterns, so that at a moment's notice they can be beamed on 24 different lands in five of the world's six warring continents. These shortwaves are not like those of our standard broadcasting band. They do not die out in a few hundred miles. They are the siege guns of radio, the heavy artillery, guns of war that can hurl explosive facts against the enemy's weapons of lies and confusion anywhere in the world. They are also potential guns of peace that can be turned against misinformation and ideas that lead to war. Tonight, we are dedicating the newest and most powerful group of shortwave broadcasting stations in the world, built for our government by the Crosley Corporation. Three brand new transmitters of 200,000 watts power each. For those who have built them, this is a proud achievement. And yet, it is only one small chapter in the story of the Voice of America.